We have our second panel on media and culture, which is going to be chaired by Ingrid Betancourt, and she is the director of the New Jersey Hispanic Research and Information Center in Newark at the Newark Public Library. But first, we have a real brief special treat from a special poet, Rich Villar, who's going to read a poem for the occasion. And then he's on the panel, so it'll lead straight into it. And this is going to be a little different. Wherever you like, sir. You have the floor.
Good morning. Almost afternoon. How are you? You have followed up the political discussion with the poet. You've gone from one set of talking to another. By far, my favorite term I think I've learned today is dream eligible. That's always fun. I guess the reason that a poet is here is to kind of remind, at least I'd like to think, is to kind of remind us all that what we are talking about here really boils down to our basic human need for empathy. And that's what this particular poem is about. This is actually a poem about my mother. This is designed to put a real human face on some of these issues that we're talking about now. There is absolutely nothing wrong with talking about numbers and talking about what we're going to do politically. But I'm of the opinion that a human face is what is needed to all of these conversations. And empathy is what we need more than anything. And I hope that this little piece that I'm going to offer you kind of puts a face on that. This is called Sali Agua. If you are of Puerto Rican descent and you remember the Aguinaldo singer Odilio González, there is some lyrics in this particular poem from him. There's a little bit of singing too, so I'm going to warn you now. My mother's nickname was Boñata, so. Boñata has learned what not to say when Macho, age 77, has taken up the harmonica after 20 years. He is hopelessly off key. It is 7 a.m. She would rather sleep or cook asopao or mend the fingers on his gloves, find his good winter coat, the one suitable for shoveling, dive under the comforter she bought with their good money, unspent on betting horses or paying for their children's automobiles. Boñata would rather not remember Tony's fist through the plate glass, Macho's fist through Tony, the 3 a.m. footfalls of her dead son, or her daughter not asleep in the next room, or the unsmiles of her youngest son, unmarried finally to the aftershock. She would rather awaken to roosters and grass, 80 degrees in January. She is on a mountainside in Fajardo. Estas son las trullas que te ofrecí. Boñata has returned to Yeya's kitchen preparando pernil. Y sali agua, nuestro idilio se volvió. Or cooking asopao at 3 a.m. She is singing the soundtracks to all her scars. The mountains of Fajardo in a defeated jeep. En tu huerto sembré una esperanza. She is shivering in the cold outside the President Palace in Passaic, asleep in the next room. She is shivering at her son's grave. Y flor de venganza tu huerto me dio. She didn't know what her heart would say the first day he pulled out his harmonica. It was 1974, and the apartment was warm, and he was warm, and she needed him. She needed for once. Tú mataste mi alegría. So she thought it was dead, and rightfully. Y algún día me la pagarás. But her soundtrack was off key, and Macho was off key. She has learned instead to love the imperfections. She has learned how history sings through the fog of mourning. She's teaching herself to maneuver around their scars, to never interrupt the song. Thank you.
Good morning. Buenos dias. Almost good afternoon. Casi buenas tardes. I'd like to invite all the members of the panel to stand, come and sit.
Sorry.
I think there's an extra seat right here now.
Or is there not? No, there isn't.
Where do I need to?
Unless she wants to move her chair there.
And then move all of us.
Well.
Thank you. I was getting moving.
We have begun the day by, thanks to Robert Montemayor and to Mark, with a terrific framework demographics and what is it that the community looks like in terms of numbers and trends and so on, which really gives us a terrific framework to move from. Then we had a very dynamic and intense conversation about the political influence that we are beginning to exert and need to continue exerting in the state of New Jersey as Latinos united, not different nationalities, but yet Latinos united also as one. But I love what Rich has just done, which was to, as he said, put a face, put a human face to the numbers and to the framework and to the trends, which is really what we're all about. And as Latinos in the state of New Jersey, and the name of this public forum is the State of Hispanic New Jersey, we exert influence by numbers, we exert influence by our buying power, we exert influence in many, many ways, certainly political power, but we also exert influence through culture and presence and history and spirit. And this is what we're going to be looking at and discussing in this portion of the program. I'd like to take a minute to thank, first of all, the Hall Institute, and to also thank the Center for Latin American Studies at Rutgers University for inviting us all to participate in this exciting public forum. And I'd like to thank each one of the panelists for accepting that invitation and traveling and being here today and bringing each one of you your own unique perspective and experience to this conversation. I think what I'd like to do is to start by introducing our panel. We have quite a distinguished and experienced panel, and I'd like all of you to know who we have at the table. I'm going to start my far right, by introducing Jorge A. Rod. Jorge is a publisher of Latinos, Unidos de New Jersey, a Spanish language newspaper that serves Ocean, Monmouth, and Middlesex County. Mr. Rod was born in Colombia and raised in Venezuela. He came to the U.S. at age 15 and served in the Army from 1965 to 1968. Mr. Rod was elected to the Lacey Township Committee for 3 consecutive terms and served as mayor and administrator. He is the first Hispanic to be elected to the New Jersey legislature representing the 9th District, New Jersey State General Assembly from 1981 to 1985. Next to Jorge, we have Linda Nieves-Powell. Linda is a writer, director, producer, author and successful entrepreneur. She is founder and president of Latino Flavor Productions, a multimedia entertainment production company that has grossed over $1 million in sales, producing theatrical shows at over 400 top-ranked colleges and universities around the country. She is the author of the novel Freestyle, published by Simon & Schuster, and numerous plays, including the critically acclaimed Yo Soy Latina. She has also written, directed, and produced short films shown at the Miami-Dade Festival, San Francisco Women's Festival, and other festivals around the country. In 2002, Ms. Nieves-Powell was named one of El Diario La Prensa's 50 most outstanding women and received the Harvard University's Fuerza Latina Award for her presentation of positive Latina images. Rich Villar, who you just heard, is a writer of Puerto Rican and Cuban ancestry, originally from Paterson, New Jersey. He's executive director of Acentos, an organization that fosters audiences and community empowerment around Latino literature. His poetry and essays have appeared in Latino Poetry Review, Beltway Poetry Quarterly, Amistad, El Centro's Letras, and the acclaimed chapbook series, Achiote Seeds. His work was commissioned for the Actor's Stock New York production of Eve Descending, in which he also appeared. Mr. Villar has read, lectured, and facilitated adult and teen poetry workshops throughout the Northeast and beyond, and received a nomination for the 2005 Pushcart Prize. He is currently working on his master's degree in poetry at Rutgers University, where he also teaches writing. Next to Rich, we have Ivette Mendez. Ivette Mendez is president of Mendez & Company, a communication strategy firm based in New Jersey, and she is founder of LatinoNJ.com, a statewide website focused on issues impacting the Latino community. She is a former newspaper reporter with the Paterson News and the Newark Star-Ledger. Ms. Mendez served as communications director for then Congressman Robert Menendez, and more recently for Governor John Corzine. She has also served as corporate spokesperson for Verizon New Jersey, Verizon International, and the Verizon Foundation. In 2007, Hispanic Business Magazine named her one of 100 influential Hispanics in the country. And last but not least, we have William Sánchez, or as everyone who knows him calls him, Willie Sánchez. Mr. Sánchez is the award-winning executive producer, director of the former NJN bilingual program, Images, Imagenes, the longest running cultural and public affairs series on any public broadcasting system in the country. For three decades, right? Willie, three decades? For three decades, Images Imagenes chronicled the history and culture of Latinos in New Jersey and focused attention on issues that impacted this community. Mr. Sánchez directed the Emmy Award-winning series on parenting titled Sembrando el Futuro, Seeding the Future. And he is the creative and motivating force behind the NJN Hispanic Youth Showcase. His dedication to the community and his professional accomplishments have earned Mr. Sánchez numerous community awards, as well as recognition from President Clinton, U.S. Congress, the New Jersey Legislature, and two New Jersey governors. His programs on the history of Latin music have been seen in South America, the Caribbean, and in Europe. So please join me in giving this terrific panel a round of applause. As we said, there are different ways that New Jersey is becoming Hispanicized. And what we'd like to look at in this particular moment, this panel, is what is the Latino imprint in New Jersey? In what ways, specifically, in what ways have Latinos presented and brought their own flavor, their own culture, expressed themselves in the media and through culture in the state of New Jersey and in mainstream America as well. But I'd like to also, let's focus on New Jersey as much as possible. And as we know, culture encompasses a number of things: music, the arts, popular culture, values, all kinds of things. So let's look at that. How are we represented? How have we impacted media and culture in New Jersey? What is the imprint? And what are some of the challenges, perhaps, that are still vibrant and need to be addressed? And what I'd like to do is perhaps start the far right with Jorge.
I'm listening to the, it's certainly a pleasure being up here with this honorable panel. I'm listening to the first panel and talk about politics, and I'm moving back and forth in my chair, and my wife gave me a warning, do not talk politics. Because I, you know, as a former assemblyman, first one in the state of New Jersey, it's always in your blood. I looked at the numbers, great presentation for Robert and Mark, kept me right in the picture. And I looked at the how we also like to call Latinos, Hispanic, and I noticed that the no preference came with 50-some percent, I believe. But I'm Latino. That's where I am. And I'm a real mixed Latino. Born in Colombia, raised in Venezuela, dad from Mexico, mother from Cuba, grandparents, Catalanos, España is like a Latino, period. How they came up, I'm not going to change the name of the paper, Latinos, Unidos, I'm just going to stay Latinos. How the Unidos came into the picture is what I like to drive across, and my message is an organized minority is a powerful majority. And that's how I came up with the Unidos. We have to unite, and we have to come a powerful majority. So I started in the publication business. I went in the Army in the publication business. I got into public administration. Then I went back into the publication business. How I decided to start this little newspaper, which is growing by leaps and bounds, and the readership is unbelievable growing because I get the calls in the office, I get the feedback from the people, is I noticed it was a void among the Hispanic community, Latino community, where there's a lot of things available to us. It's a lot of things available in this country, in the state, in the counties that I serve, that the Latino community is not aware of. A lot of things. And I noticed in the survey, I did 5 out of 5. I talk about jobs. When I get into the subject of jobs, I talk about a score. It's a nonprofit organization that would like to get people to go into business, help them with business at no cost, volunteer business people that would like to see a lot of Latinos, because I talk to them, I like to see a lot of Latinos get involved, have a business, run the business properly, accountability. Then I notice on education, I touch on that in education, health, taxes, economic trends. Basically, the newspaper that I publish is a educational newspaper. News you can get on TV, you can get on the daily newspapers, but my purpose of the newspaper is to educate the Latino community. Tell them what's available. You have local UEZ zones. I believe you have 10, 15 UEZ zones in the state of New Jersey. I know in areas where they have 450 members, only 3 are Latino-owned businesses. I promote the fact that there is benefits to belong to the local economic organization. There is benefits, And we have increased from 3 to 7, but we did 4 more. We have 4 more people that actually participate. And I talk about the volunteers. You know, we have organizations like caregivers, their programs, and so on. So those are the subjects that I concentrate on so I can educate the Latino community, because I think it's very important for us to take advantage of what's out there and educate us and constantly communicate among us. I say thank you.
Thank you, Jorge.
Well, I got my start here, actually, at Rutgers University. I play Yo Soy Latina. I was playing monthly at the New Eurekan Poets Cafe, and a few girls from Lambda Theta Alpha sorority came and loved it so, and they wanted me to bring it here. And the minute this play performed here, it was like, it just went like wildfire, because the girls wound up telling all their sisters across the country about this play, about 6 diverse Latinas. And before you know it, it was almost like I had 40 performances in a 3-month period. It was very, it was intense, which is why in time it was able to make over $1 million. It was through the college initiative, all those bookings that we got. But it's ironic, the whole story behind Yo Soy Latina, because I didn't get any support from Latino theaters. And I still don't know why. I did manage to get an equity production at Crossroads Theater here in New Brunswick, which is an African-American theater company, and they did extremely well with that show. So I feel a little like the rebellious person when I talk about the Latino experience and what I do. I feel that the word unity is a funny word for us. We don't know how to do that. And when I developed the concept for Yo Soy Latina, it was a very organic thing that happened. I was invited to a barbecue. This prominent attorney in Staten Island thought if I hung out at his barbecue, he knew a lot of theater people, somebody would see me, you know, I would get it. It was a networking thing. He said, but the only way you can come to this barbecue is if you perform, write and perform a monologue. And I'm like, I don't perform. All right, then I'll try to write the monologue. So I sat there for a whole weekend trying to write something that I could perform. Well, I didn't go, but I did write it. And it was called Yo Soy Latina, and it was about this girl that was just so tired of misrepresentation in the media. She wanted to be who she was. She was a mixture of all things, and it just sat there for a while. And I decided to put it on the internet, and I think that was in 1997 when, I don't know if you remember, AOL had, like, you could have your little homepage, your little, it was the beginning of things. I took advantage of that very early on, and it paid off, because that monologue traveled all over. And when I found those responses from people that they were saying, oh my God, yes, that's how I feel, I said, oh my God, I'm not the only one feeling like this. So I started interviewing Latinas. And in the process of interviewing Latinas, I developed these 6 characters that wind up at a seminar. What is a Latina seminar? The facilitator never arrives, and they wind up trying to figure this out on their own. So this is why it was a huge success, because we were talking about ourselves. But at the same time, I was dealing with this very weird dynamic. Here is a great play, resonating with so many people, making money. Isn't that the whole reason you would want to put it up in your theater? I was getting no support from my own theater. Now, I will say the New Eurekan Poets Cafe was the only place that it survived. And then when Crossroads came along, that was even a bigger boost. So there's this word unity. And, you know, just recently on Facebook, I saw a posting about the Maid show that's coming up with Eva Longoria. And there is no unity when you're talking about this, because on one hand, well, you know, it's 4 Latinas, you know, being featured and starred in this primetime show, but it's about maids. And Eva Longoria's defense is, you know, these stories need to be told too. And my answer to that is, well, yeah, there's prostitutes out there too, and their stories need to be told. So at what point are we gonna, for me, it's about balance. I don't think we're balanced yet in this industry yet. We haven't told all the stories that we wanted to tell the way we want to tell them. And until we get there, everything is unfair for me. You know, it is the truth. We have to get to a place where we can say everything we have to say, get it out there, even if we don't all agree on it. We don't all have to agree on it, but it has to be, we have to be able to say it, do it the way we want to do it, and then maybe we'll balance the scales. But until then, I don't see any balance. It's like this right now. And everything up here is what I don't really care to see all the time. So I can go on tangents forever, so you have to shut me up. But
this is a good one. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, it's I'm confused. I'm an artist trying to create stuff for my people, and not always does it. Look, for instance, freestyle. Very funny novel. You can say whatever it is. It's not meant to be literature. It's meant to be fun. I didn't get any support from Simon & Schuster. I had to sell that on my own. It's very difficult to sell that on your own. I had no support. And, you know, I was a newbie author. I didn't know that you had to sell your own books. And that happens to a lot of us. You'll see a lot of our books out there.
Yeah.
And no, how am I? You walk into a bookstore, it's the most intimidating thing. There are so many books. How are you going to say, no, pick this one. This is going to change your life. No, it's not going to change your life, but you're going to have fun reading it. I mean, it's very, very difficult. We have a big problem. I don't. And I've spent a lot of time dealing with the identity, the Latina identity, a lot of time. And what I find is we evolve. Every 5-10 years, we evolve. So it's very hard to say this is who we are because we're not the same person we were 10 years ago. When my grandmother was around, I was a different person. When my grandmother passed away, all of that left. There's nobody to go home and to where they cook meals for you in that way, and I can't go back to Puerto Rico where she lived in a shack and experience that anymore. I go to Clearwater, Florida now, and my mother lives near the beach, you know? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I don't know, but I love these things because I like to hear all sides, and maybe it helps me figure out where we're gonna go next.
Well, let me pick up on a point that you mentioned in terms of your novel, and you mentioned that it's how difficult it is to get the word out, to get your voice out as a Latina in, you know, the mainstream media, whether it's in theater, literature, and, you know, we have had, we have organized panels at the Newark Public Library, the Hispanic Center, also on Latina writers, Latina voices, and Each one of them that's had the same thing to say, that it's so difficult to get published, it's so difficult to get, because they look at you and they say there's no market for you, there's really not a market.
But they publish you.
But you have to go and go do your own thing, right. You know, and or they're looking for the typical stories that they expect, the stereotypical stories. Right. Did you have anything to add to that? Because you've had that experience as well.
About stereotypical stories?
Yeah, you know.
Remind me, because
well, you know, when we had Esmeralda Santiago, of course, you know, has come to the library and presented and talked about her journey when she was writing her books, and it was a memoir, you know, the memoir, like my experience, my life experience, coming up, growing up in Puerto Rico, and that's terrific. But we are more than that.
We are more than that. We have so many sides, and I think we're confusing people. We're confusing ourselves as well. Because it's almost like we're not ready to hear everything yet. We're a part of the problem. Let's not get it twisted. We are. We have to figure out why we don't like certain things, why we do like certain things, why we can't support. Somebody said to me yesterday, we all need to support one project fully, 100%. But here's another side to this. What if it's a piece of crap? It's hard. I want to be able to see that happen. How do we do that? And the other panel, when they were talking about supporting people, politicians, you know, people who are speaking on our behalf. Well, let me tell you, on MTV, they had this show called True Life New Yorkans. And I just happened to catch it one night, and I flipped. three stereotypical Puerto Ricans as low can be, and I'm sure it's the way they wanted it to be when they showed it. It was horrendous. It was embarrassing. I made a big deal about it, and a whole bunch of us got together, and it's no longer, it will never, ever be played on television again. Whose idea was it? A South American. So you see why I'm all confused? So, we have a lot of talking to do.
We have definitely much talking to do about this. So, we're going to come back and recycle, but let's give, because time is an issue as well, let's give Rich a chance to throw in his 2 cents.
Okay. Thank you for that segue. In 2003, a couple of friends of mine and I wandered into a bar in the South Bronx called the Blue Ox Bar. It's on 139th Street and 3rd Avenue. We did not have an intention of creating any kind of organization around poets and around Latino poets. And we certainly didn't have any kind of intention of making any kind of noise about our representation in mainstream American literature. All we wanted to do was stand in front of a microphone and read our crappy poems to each other. And we did. Then we started reading other people's poetry. And then we started reading other Latino poetry. And we started reading New Eurekan poets. And then we started reaching out to the Southwest, and we discovered Jimmy Santiago Baca, Lorna D. Cervantes, Alfred Arteaga, the voices of the Chicano movement. And we discovered that there were linkages there too. And then, as the internet became, being what it is, the word began to spread that there is this reading series in the South Bronx called Acentos, and it features Latino writers. There were other readings, obviously, in other parts of the country, but as has been touched on by both the economists, the politicians, and now some of the literary folk, we are sprinkled throughout the country like pepper. And we tend to try to find each other, and there's all these little enclaves of people that create, and we find each other. So before you knew it, we started having people show up at our bar. And some of these writers were from Texas and from California. Some of them were from Florida. And yes, some of them were the elders of the Eureka movement, like Victor Hernandez Cruz, Santa Maria Esteves, basically anyone you could name. We've had anywhere from 150 to 175 different poets come in and out of our door. That eventually segued into a writer's workshop in which we basically sat around and started workshopping each other's crappy poems into something that is more representative of the kind of literature, as Linda points out, that maybe is not so simplistic or indeed complicates the story, which is a concept I'll get into in a little bit. That began to segue into a journal. A literary journal. Reina Leon, who is a professor of education out at, St. Mary's College in the Bay Area. I believe it's in the Bay Area. I forget where she's disappeared to now. But she co-founded that journal with another writer named Elia Lucero. I eventually came on as a fiction editor for that as well. And we were at the time one of two major literary journals in the country that featured all Latino writers. In our first month, we featured spoken word artists. We featured writers who have anywhere between 20 and 30 books under their belt, and we had a whole range of ages and publication levels. And that was the kind of work that we wanted to do. We wanted to sort of shine a spotlight on the Latino voice in American letters, and that's what my organization has come to represent. Acentos is, or at least at one point, was a reading series. It is a workshop series from time to time. We do readings and symposia around Latino literature. We organized a reading of about 33 different Latino poets when the writers, the AWP conference was in New York City in 2008. And they were writers from all across the spectrum, from all over the country, and it was a beautiful event, which we have documented as well. And in 2011, we organized a reading, a multicultural reading, writers that were responding to the SB 1070 law in Arizona. And what we found is that the more we travel and the more we advocate, the more that we run into writers that have the same kind of anxieties that a lot of the politicians in this room probably have, or a lot of the policymakers in this room probably have. And it's the same problem that exists all across the board, whether you're talking about politics, whether you're talking about literature, whether you're talking about your relations with your neighbors, whether you're talking about food, whether you're talking about sociology, any science, anything you can study at the university level, or even at the high school level. The fundamental question of American existence has always been this question of otherness. Who's got the right to claim themselves, to claim this thing called America? Okay? And we fragment ourselves and we fracture ourselves and we say, I'm half this and I'm half that and I'm a quarter this and, you know, my parents were from wherever. When in reality, we are 100% of everything. Despite the statistics, and you know, no disrespect to the gentleman who brought the numbers to us, because they are important to understand. But I think the fundamental problem for me goes beyond the numbers. It is the idea that we have to answer the census at all, one way or the other. I think they woke up a little bit this year with being able to check off different racial identities, in addition to being Hispanic, because we are not just white non-Hispanic. Some of us are mixed race non-Hispanic. Some of us are mixed race Hispanic. Some of us are Latino. But you know what? We are 100% of everything we claim. We are not half of anything. When I tell people what I am, I tell them I am 100% Latino. I am 100% American. I am 100% Puerto Rican. And I am 100% Cuban. I am not a fraction of anything. I am a whole person. And this is the fundamental thing that I've wanted my organization to come back to. And how does it impact New Jersey? Well, I'll tell you how it impacts New Jersey. When you look at the average anthology for poetry or for literature, unless it says the Norton Anthology of Latino Literature, you're not going to find a lot of Latinos in it. You know, you'll find a whole listing of every canonical poet that they tell us to study. And then you might find Francisco Alarcón, maybe. You might find Martin Espada, the Puerto Rican poet from the University of Massachusetts. You might find a few names from the New Eureka Movement, if you're lucky. But you're not going to find a major representation of who we truly are in this country. Our story is not complicated enough. Our story is the story of people who have come here. It is the classic immigration story. It is the classic story of people who come together and create new identities, okay? My goal, and if you look at the average study of Puerto Rican literature, you know, in the Northeast, always centers on the New Eureka Movement, and there's nothing wrong with that. But New Jersey has a lot of Latino writers in it, some of whom are not published, but who want to be. And who want to have organizations like mine and people like Linda and others who speak out on their behalf to get their stories into the mainstream, so to speak, or to get their stories into quote-unquote mainstream publications. But the only way we're really going to do that is if everyone from the top down begins to exercise a little bit of empathy for their fellow human being. It has nothing to do with numbers. It has nothing to do with what we can argue about with Governor Christie today. It has everything to do with promoting the idea of a very human idea of empathy for your fellow man. That's all. That's once you have that, you can start discussing things on a human level, right? And my goal is to complicate the story as much as possible. Complicate the story, because you know what? We are not just tortillas and penil. We are not the food we eat. We are not the hair. We are not our hair texture. We are complex human beings with complex stories. And that's what we have to represent. Whether you're talking about New Jersey or whether you're talking about the national level, it has to be complicated.
Thank you, Rich. That is absolutely true, and that is something that has come up in, you know, in some of the, you know, everybody, you know, some of the people have that have commented already. The complexity of what it is to be a Latino in terms of everything, nationality, background, political persuasion, interest, race, you know, everything. And it is, you're right, it is a complicated story that it is being told. Thank you.
And that's a perfect segue about the perfect story to be told, because I wanted to focus on Latinos in the media, Latinos in New Jersey in the media, and I can just say this. I've been a very close observer and a participant for many, many years since junior high school, middle school, as a reporter, and it's been a roller coaster ride. And I'm gonna really focus on New Jersey because I'm very familiar with the media here in New Jersey. Can I just ask, how many people here can name a reporter in New Jersey, a Latino reporter? 1, 2, 3, 4.
That's
oh. Okay. How many of those are in a weekly newspaper, belong to a weekly newspaper? How many of those reporters? Okay. Are they all at dailies? The reporters that you know, are they at dailies? No? No, right? Okay. If you go into our newsrooms today, you're not going to find Latinos. Excuse me, because I'm used to being behind the scenes, not in front of an audience. And you know, it's a shame that the audience is very sparse now, because all of the issues that we've been discussing, how to get the word out, why, you know, we need to go out and discuss this, fight for it, be part of the cause, be part of the solution. And, you know, and it's very sad that a lot of folks already left. Robert had mentioned, when he was talking about his numbers, it's a tough story, but it's better that you know. But how are we going to know if we are not represented anymore in the media? When I started out as a print reporter, again, junior high school, college, Douglas College graduate, Rutgers here. I worked on the Kalian. When I started my first newspaper job at a daily, I was the first Latina. I was the only Latina, first and only. Then I went over to the Newark Star Ledger, again, same thing. But then the story started to change. I was so excited. They were looking for Hispanics to come into the newsroom and be members of the media. It was like really exciting. I don't know if you remember that. And you know, we had a few more come in. Some of the daily newspapers in New Jersey, you might remember this, started Spanish sections in Perth Amboy, and a couple other places. Then what happened? The economy, boom, tanked. Okay, that's gonna be one of the reasons that is given. Advertising went down, and who? If you look, the newsroom population went down. Our Latino peeps out the door. So who's going to be telling our story? As a reporter, I know I was always told to. I was given the Latino stories, and I agree with Christian when he says all issues are Latino. You know, it's not like we have Latino issues. All issues are related to Latinos. Right now, who do we have covering our stories? I'm trying to keep this very, very short. Like, and who, if you look at who is being asked to comment in the newspaper, when are Latinos asked to comment? When it comes to immigration, you know, when it comes to, like, maybe housing, health, whatever, and I remember this often in the newsroom. They would say, go find a Latino to talk about, you know, immigration, whatever. And it's crazy. And then they would all lump us together, Hispanic, you know, Hispanic versus Latino, we would all be the same. I remember many times being asked what to order in a Mexican restaurant, you know. I don't know what a chimichanga is. I got to look at the menu. And I wrote a column about that. So our faces are lacking in the newsroom, but I have to give the weeklies, the Latino weeklies, have been a steady presence in New Jersey. I have to give them credit. Some of the faces I've seen for decades almost, and I'm dating myself, And I give them props. They have a tough job trying to get advertising. So support our Latino weeklies. And just a little update on Latinos New Jersey, my website. I started that with so much passion. And I'm very emotional. As a lot of people here know, I cry very easily. But I am Puerto Rican.
We all do, yeah.
That's know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Don't feel bad.
I started it with passion, but I made a mistake. I didn't have a business plan. You know, hello. So, and I had major bloggers. I had Senator Menendez, Sulima Farber, our first attorney general. I had a Javier Robles, a big disability advocate major who's in the last row here. It was an amazing website, but I had no money to run it. It was me, myself and I. So, but it's not a dead dream. You know, I'm a writer and I'll be a writer till the day I take my last breath. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ivette. You know, in terms of media, New Jersey is, you know, it's overshadowed on the one side by New York, on the other side by, you know, by Philadelphia. So that's one strike. The other thing is also, in terms of Latinos in New Jersey, I mean, that's talking about dating ourselves, but remember the O.J. Simpson trial? And how paralyzed, you know, that paralyzed the country. And everybody that was a touchstone would talk about this and talk about that. And wherever you saw anything, you know, about what do people think about this was whites think this, blacks think that. Nobody else existed. Nobody else had an opinion. I had an opinion. All my friends had an opinion. But we weren't visible. We were not visible in any way. And it's just something. Part of what you are alluding to for different reasons, but okay, let's move on and we can come back and talk a little bit more. But I'd like to turn the mic over to Mr. Sanchez.
Willie.
Saludo. I guess I want to get a little bit into my personal life, and then I want to get into Imagenes and take you on what's happening now in the media and why you're 20 years behind the times.
Can you all hear? Okay.
Can you hear me? Okay, here we go. So again, I want to tell you a little bit about myself. Basically, I'm a product of an unpaid grocery bill. My grandmother couldn't pay the bill. And my mother took me to meet my grandfather, and I took a candy bar from his bodega, which was supposed to be the best one in town, and he asked my mother, was she gonna pay for it? Okay, I learned there that I was black, and found out that my father, when my grandmother had him, she passed away. And he became an orphan, he joined the circus, he became payaso and a clown in the Pan American Circus. He was a payaso chipitita, a little bit. But he was also a very dedicated person. He never went to school. He never learned how to write. Came to the United States in 1951, and in 1955 he called us over. When we came over, my family was not Puerto Rican, we were Spanish. We were Spanish because the census said Spanish. We were Spanish because at that time you didn't want to say Puerto Ricans, because there was a very negative image about what Puerto Ricans were based on what happened in Congress, based on the Cape Man. And so being Puerto Rican was always in the news when something negative was happening, but not when something positive was happening. So I was Spanish in the 50s, in the 60s, and I gotta tell you, when I went to school, I sat in the back of the class, couldn't understand a word of what was being said. So one day I came with powder all over my face and I sat in the back of the room. raised my hand when the teacher asked a question. Didn't know what she asked, but I knew I had the powder. I was gonna come out with the answer. Instead, they pulled me to the front of the room. They started yelling at me for putting on powder. They called my parents in. They didn't know my mother was upset because I used their powder. But the whole point I was trying to get them to understand is that I wanted to be as smart as the Irish kids in my classroom. And one day I saw an Irish kid walk to St. Patrick's, that's where I went, and I saw him kneeling in front of a Virgin Mary, and I said, that's how he does it. And I went, and I kneeled, and I said, give me, what do you got? For a long time, what I wore on my head was my mother's stocking and the pin for your laundry on my nose. Because they told me if I brush my hair 100 times, it would go straight. And if I did my nose like this 100 times, it would go straight. So that was my growing up. In the 60s, I became a Puerto Rican. And my goal was to go back to the community and grab all of those kids in my neighborhood so they wouldn't have to go through what I went through. Okay. Eventually, three Puerto Ricans came into my neighborhood, and one Dominican, by the way, his name is Ramon Garizal, came into my neighborhood on 7th Avenue, which I gotta tell you, where Rutgers University is in Newark, that's where my home used to be. And my father, who couldn't write and read a little bit, became the district leader. And the most powerful Puerto Rican organization was Rutgers University, Rutgers University. That community was split up and destroyed, and the political power left it. It ended up at Rutgers, eventually, by these three people, after they came to Columbus Homes. And they brought me and they said, you're going to college. I said, you're crazy. I eventually ended up in college, and I'm proud to say that that was one of the most beautiful things that ever happened to me. There I met some really positive people, including Gloria Montealegre, mm-hmm. who I'm glad she's here because she's the one that's responsible for me being in television. Because she dragged me out after I told her I don't want to do television, I want to do theater. Because I was working to try to do what Marvin Camilo, who's a friend of mine, did. That was direct on Broadway. He did Short Eyes. And I did a small version of Short Eyes. But my goal was never television. Gloria was working in television. You drag me out there, you're going to do television. I haven't been able to go back to theater. But to look at what media was, and I'm 100% thankful to Gloria, because if she didn't make that, do what she did, I wouldn't be here. And I feel like the luckiest man in the world. I was born on April 13th,
1951.
Oh, well. Yeah.
All right.
Feliz cumpleaños, Willie.
How was the media in New Jersey? There was no media covering Latinos in New Jersey. We didn't exist. And I'm glad you mentioned the local newspapers, because the Spanish local newspapers is how communication happened within the state of New Jersey. Without the little papers, there was nothing. Channel 47 was in Symphony Hall in Newark, and the two top programs they had was Don Pasante and a boxing show, and Polito Vega's Salsarengue, where the kids dance. But did they go into the community and cover the stories of that community? No. Unless something happened, like the networks did, crime here, mm-hmm. crime there. Well, what about the stories of the Latino community? Didn't happen. Then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Channel 13 came out with the show called Realidades. Realidades was awesome. This program that shows that really blew everybody away. And I was in college and I was like, wow. They told the story of Angelito Negro with Willie Colon. Classic. I'm still looking for it. And that's the formula that led to the creation of Images Imagines. In Trenton, a group of Puerto Ricans got together with the Mexicans and they fought the station. And they say, you're not going forward in 1970 when public broadcasting came on unless you have a Latino program. And they held up the license, and Images Imagines went on the air on January 6, 1972. And our responsibility was to cover Latinos from South Jersey to North Jersey, because North Jersey didn't know what was happening in South Jersey, and South Jersey didn't want anything to do with North Jersey because they were to Philadelphia. We're connected to, so here we are, and we needed to tell the stories of North Jersey and South Jersey so they would be connected and united as one. So we went to the Puerto Rican Congress, which at the time was the leading organization doing this same thing that you're doing now. Doing the same thing, and the media and culture workshops were very, very small. Because people were dealing with major, major issues. So we decided that the way to deal with these major issues to find out what they were. So the first thing that came out of there was a program on alcoholism, because the men in our community were turning to alcohol because they couldn't find jobs. And while their wives got jobs because of the factories and dowel making and embroidery that's part of New Jersey, the men did not. And those coming migrants who were coming here to work in Puerto Rico, they were not getting the opportunity to work, so they turned to alcoholism. The interesting thing about that is that once we did the show, went on the air, it became one of the top programs on any station. And the Department of Alcoholism saw it and changed a whole spectrum on how to deal with Latinos, because the issue was mental health. Okay?
Is it
tissue? Huh? I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I apologize. The issue was mental health, something that had not been touched on or seen, because we were living in stereotypes of what the Latino was. Mm-hmm. Then there was the issue of interpretation, and I'm going to being interpreters. And I'm going to tell you something. When I came here, my father brought me to the courts to be an interpreter. I was 10 years old, because there were none. And it was these two guys were standing next to a car, and they were put in jail. And the judge asked me to ask them what were they doing standing next to this car. And they said they were just standing next to the car, and women were going by, and they were tirándole flores. So, you know, and so I said to the judge, they were standing there, and these women were going by, and they were throwing flowers at them. The judge was totally upset and kept yelling at them to look at him. They refused to look at him. And then I looked at the judge and I said, they can't look at you, that's a sign of disrespect. Because I didn't, in the court system, you have to look at the person. They were not looking at. So that was another reason why we needed to do shows. Imagenes became the mirror. Images, Imagenes became a mirror. Of how we can look at ourselves and how other people have looked at us. So we can use this mirror to build bridges of understanding in our culture and history. What did we do? We did a Latinization of New Jersey show. Who do we beat? ABC World News tonight. We went to the finals in the Unity Awards in St. Louis, and everybody was there talking to Peter Jennings y a mí a la esquinita when they announced the winner. And I flew back with my award, and I can tell you right now that Images Imagenes has been to the Emmys 21 of the 28 years. And again, Gloria Montalegre worked with me for 7 years, and she was the best thing that ever happened to me because she was wonderful in my life and also in the program. But I want to get to this because this is where things are becoming crucial right now, and I'm sorry I'm taking too long, but I'll get to this real quick. I've been to three major conferences with presidents of the top corporations, networks, NBC, CBS, have all gathered in these meetings where you and I cannot go to because they're too expensive. Mm. Okay? But this is, but I saw what happened when the Latino market became $95 billion. And it was almost like a race. They were all standing in line like this, ready to jump on it, right? Then when it got to $300 billion, boom. The most powerful market right now, and they're calling it the boom, the Latino boom. This is not the Latino boom. This is going to, there's going to be a major boom for Latinos when they start growing and making a major difference. And the way, for example, if you look at what's happening and how they're looking at it, McDonald's uses a 30-40-50 rule. That means that 30% of their customers are multicultural. 40% of their sales, and account for 40% of their sales, and 50% of their multicultural population is under 18. So any company that looked at us as a 30, 40, 50 population that met their consumer growth, they're in our neighborhoods. And those are the ones that are doing programming. So Azteca, you're getting a lot of programs coming in to television now from out of South America, Mexico, and all other places. And yes, you're getting programs like the one you said. And if you all look at the history of what Images Imagenes has done, Images Imagenes for 40 years was your voice. We told your stories. And out of that came the Hispanic Youth Showcase. When I was told, where are you going to find Latinos with talent? I was told that. Well, guess what? We've had 9,500 kids come out of this show. At age 5, they started learning how to do television. And they've had missions. This is Veronica Cole. She's one of the ones that has learned. And later on, when we have a chance at the end of this, I'm going to have her speak, because you got to listen to what mission she's on right now. So I'll turn it over. Any questions, I'll be glad to.
Well, before we close the panel, I think it's, first of all, thank you, Willie, for sharing your personal history and for sharing it, how important in public television, you know, the presence of Latinos in public television, and like you say, mirroring, reflecting the culture, reflecting our presence in the state of New Jersey, that has been invaluable, you know, for the 30, I thought it was 30, 40 years that has been, you know, two generations. Absolutely. Thank you for your work, and thank you for sharing that with us.
I just want to mention one last thing. Television, forget television. It's not what it is. What it is now is not what it's going to be in the future. It's going to be the internet.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? It's going to be the internet.
It is.
All this smart TV talk is just updated computer. Okay? It's a television. Now, here's the statistics. A study shows that 86% of the Latino community is hooked to the internet. 76% use it on a daily basis. What does that mean? It means that the Latino on Google is worth $200 million. And what I want you guys to know is that you have to start creating your own television systems and studios in your own homes, in your own community, in your own businesses. Because there's going to come a point where that's how you're going to be communicating with each other and telling your own stories. And I want stories about everything that we talked about here. Okay.
Ingrid, I just want to say, you're absolutely right, and I'm so glad you brought that up, because I worked on my first web series. It's called Happy Cancer Chick, and it's inspired by Jenny Saldana, a young Dominican woman who was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she's a six-year survivor. We decided to take a comedic look, and I learned a lot in 2 years. I learned editing, I learned shooting, I love technology, and I just learned so much. And the wonderful thing that just came out of that is that we were invited to the Writers Guild of America to become members. It's not the perfect series. I can tell you that we need to work on it. We didn't have a lot of money to do the first season, but now we have a second season. And and you're absolutely right, because I probably would have never gotten into the guild any other way, which is ironic. So yes, there's such power in doing it on your own and learning that way. I agree.
And there is power in telling our stories. There is power in speaking our stories and letting our voice be present, be heard. And before we go, I think it's important to share, before we close this panel, that in terms of New Jersey, Latinos in New Jersey, there is little documentation. The images that are present are stereotypical in many ways, or absent from most of the major media outlets. But I'd like to share with you that because of this, at the New York Public Library, we have has developed the New Jersey Hispanic Research and Information Center, which one of its main goals is to capture, to rescue the history and the presence and the stories of Latinos in the state of New Jersey. The Center for Puerto Rican Studies at CUNY has done a marvelous job for almost 40 years in documenting the history of Puerto Ricans in the Northeast in general. But we are focusing, they have a broader perspective, we are focusing on Latinos in the state of New Jersey, from Vineland all the way up to, from Southern Jersey, Central Jersey up to Northern Jersey. The stories of people like Willie Sanchez and people that have made a Gloria, everybody who had made their life in New Jersey and whose stories are not heard, they're not captured. You think about who writes the storybooks, years from now, who's gonna talk about New Jersey and Latinos in New Jersey? Where are they gonna get the sources to do the research and investigate and write the stories and write the history books so we are present and we are represented adequately and truthfully? We are collecting, we have an archive, a Puerto Rican community archive. Puerto Ricans are the largest community in the state of New Jersey and the oldest one, so we've begun with that. And we have a Puerto Rican community archive, and we have a Latino oral history project, which is not only limited to any one group, but to all Latinos. And we're going and interviewing people who have made a life in New Jersey and have contributed in many different ways and capturing their stories. So that's my two cents, just because I don't want, it's important for you to know, and if you like more information or have a story to contribute, please come see me afterwards.
I just want you to know how good they are. When I was doing the story on Latinos in baseball, because they asked me to do it because they were doing this, I went there and they found a birth certificate. The name on that birth certificate was Theodore Stevens Williams. That's what Major League Baseball had. They found their certificate that said Teodoro Alfonso Williams. Ted Williams was half Mexican.
And nobody knew.
Wow.
I didn't know that.
That's what happens.
And because of the issues of discrimination, he kept it quiet and even changed his name. And once I aired the show, I got calls from lawyers from Boston. What do you mean? And I said, we got the birth certificate. And that's the kind of research that's being done. And I'm sorry I wasn't able to turn everything else I had to you, but this, they're wonderful. They are simply wonderful. I'm sorry.
Thank you so much. We are very, very pressed for time. I've been told that we will not be taking questions at this moment, that at the end, thank you, sorry, at the end. But I do want to, Willie has brought a guest to the panel, and she has a very important message. And because we are so short on time, I've asked her to limit it to 2 to 3 minutes at the most.
All right, so hi, my name's Veronica Cole. I'm 17 years old and I'm a pop singer and actress from Freehold, New Jersey. And being in the arts, I am a Latino Italian girl, and people are normally like, hey, we should cast you because you have the look and all this stuff about a look and all this stuff about what you look like and race and this and that. But in school, it's 10 times tougher, and I'm here to speak about the kids that are silenced, about the bullying, about everything that we experience when we're kids because of the fact that we are Latinos and because of the fact that we're different than anyone else. And I felt insecure and misunderstood and unwelcome, and they're very painful words, and those are what I felt when I was a kid. And when I was very little, all you cared about was what color you were taking out of the crayon box and who was gonna play with the Barbies or the Legos first. But when you get older, your look, your skin color, your clothes, your taste in music, and everything about you feels like another reason for someone to pick on you or for someone to bring you out of the crowd and make fun of you for no reason. But I started speaking about this because this past summer I've gotten many more fans and I've gotten people actually paying attention to what I do. And it came to my surprise that one of my fans messaged me one day and told me that one of my fans committed suicide from bullying. And at that point, I decided to make a change. Now, Mr. Willie Sanchez has taken a huge, huge impression on my life. I won Hispanic Youth Showcase around 2 years ago for the teen vocal division. And since then, he called me and asked me to host the show this year. I went to the auditions, made a speech, and I figured that I should really make a campaign out of this and I should try to change something in this world. And within the past less than 2 weeks, I started my own Facebook group. And like you guys said, everything is the internet now. Mm-hmm. I started my own Facebook like page. And since then, 2,000 people are supporting my new cause, Become a Role Model, Stop Bullying. And right now I have shirts and I'm trying to get sponsorships and financial and tour schools, talk to schools, talk to kids, be able to spread the message that maybe we're not able to stop bullying because everyone is so different, but there's a way to change it. There's a way to come together and become a united force, to spread the word, to make sure that people know that there's always someone there for everyone. And it's not only the kids that get bullied, it's all of us too. It doesn't matter if it's government, workplace, anything. People become profiled because of who they are, what they look like, their race, their religion, their ethnicity, everything. We're all being bullied, no matter how old you are, no matter how young you are. So I'm here to tell you guys, I basically started this less than 2 weeks ago. I'm trying to get some more support on this. Mr. Willie Sanchez has been a great impression on my life, and this panel has been absolutely incredible. Let's give him another hand. Really, they are incredible. They're incredible people to look to. I was kind of shocked at their credits because I'm only 17 and I haven't even graduated high school yet, but hey. But I'm just trying to make a change. I want to be one of those people that at a young age make a change in their life, that are able to make something out of themselves before they hit 18. So, thank you. My name is Veronica Cole, K-O-L-E. If you look it up, it's called Become a Role Model, V-E-R-O-L-E-M-O-D-E-L, Stop Bullying Campaign. It's on Facebook. Spread the message, spread the word. Make sure that there's always someone there for these kids, because they won't talk to adults, they won't talk to teachers, they'll talk to their peers, they'll talk to kids who understand them. And that's why I got involved. It's a kids helping kids thing. And thank you guys so much. I know I'm very limited on time and I don't want to press it, but thank you guys so much.
Thank you so much, Veronica, Willie, Yvette, Rich, Linda, Jorge. Thank you all for your contributions and thank you for your contributions and your attention.